Okay, so I think all of you who are on Zoom know how to play. Enter the pin 8991199. Enter it on the Kahoot app. Once you enter the pin, you'll be able to play. If you have two devices, that's better. It's quicker. If you have one device, it's all right. The questions will be displayed on Zoom and you'll be able to answer on Kahoot. Okay, so there are 30 questions and the pattern is NEET PG pattern, and there are lots of recalls from NEET PG and INICT previous AIMS papers. The topic for today's quiz is early pregnancy complications. So that includes all your first trimester bleeding, ectopic, molar, all that. So it's a very important topic because you always, always, always get a question. If you pick up any paper in the previous years, any paper, you will have one question from early pregnancy. So it's a very important topic, okay? And it's important that you get these right. It's a very simple topic. It's not too complicated. Lots of clinical situations come from ectopic pregnancy. You should be clear when to do what. Okay, so some people are logging off, maybe some connection problem. We'll wait for another 2 minutes and then we start. Okay, we have 7 on Kahoot. I had wanted more, but it's all right. We won't wait any longer. Just another 2 minutes for those who lost connection. We'll wait because I can see 10 people on Zoom. Okay, 9 on Kahoot. All right. So I think we can start. All right. Should we start? Or wait for another 1 minute. It's just almost 6:05. Okay, good enough. I think we'll start. Anyone who joins later, the pin will be at the bottom. They can join. Okay, so another person has joined. Okay, so I think we start. We have 10 people. That's good. And I think we're good to go. So let's start the quiz. Okay, so the topic is early pregnancy complications and we start. Okay, a 24-year-old lady with missed periods and mild spotting PV, UPT is positive. All are possible diagnoses except complete abortion, missed abortion, threatened abortion, or implantation bleed. All are possible except. The only information given is missed period and mild spotting PV with a positive urine pregnancy test. So all are possible except. Four seconds remaining. Okay, so all are possible. Most of you didn't get this. Okay, so all are possible except a complete abortion. Why not a complete abortion? Because there's no history of passage of a fleshy mass. Or in a missed abortion, there will be a missed period with mild spotting. Spotting can be plus or minus. Usually there is mild spotting. Threatened abortion always usually presents with spotting, and implantation bleed obviously will present with spotting. So complete abortion, there will be a history of a lot of bleeding with the passage of a fleshy mass. And that is why in this given scenario, the least likely possibility is a complete abortion. Okay, so let's see who got those right. So Ridhima and Ashraman got it right. So that's the scoreboard for now. Next question. Question number 2. The most common cause for spontaneous first trimester abortion is it? Is it chromosomal aneuploidy, chromosomal euploidy, congenital anomaly, or a balanced translocation? The most common cause for spontaneous first trimester loss. Most of you have answered. I think most of you should get this right. Very good. So most of you got this right. And those joining in late, the pin is down below 8991199. You can still join the game. There's still 28 questions to go. So whoever's joining in now, enter the pin and start playing. Let's see the scoreboard if it's changed. Okay, so Ridhima, Ashraman, AKKK, and it's me. All right, so this is an easy question. The most common cause of spontaneous first trimester abortions is chromosomal aneuploidies. All right. So next question. A 24-year-old primary with 5 weeks with spotting PV. On examination, the os is closed. A TVS shows this. What is the most likely diagnosis? Is it a complete abortion? Is it an incomplete abortion? Is it a threatened abortion? Or is it an... I can't see that, okay, because my screen is there. Or is it choice number D, which I think is an ectopic pregnancy? Okay. So what is the most likely diagnosis? In 5 weeks, spotting PV, ultrasound image shows this. All Okay, most of you got this right. I'm very glad. It was a little tricky. This is a threatened abortion. This is a true gestational sac which was seen. In a complete abortion, it will be an empty uterine cavity. Then incomplete abortion, you'll find retained products of conception. You won't see the sac. You'll see heteroechoic products. You won't see the sac as clearly as was shown. So this is a threatened abortion. And most of you got this right. Okay, so the scoreboard, same rhythm, Ashraman on top, AKKK, it's me on top. All right, next question. Question number four, identify this procedure. What is this procedure that is being shown? Is it McDonald's cerclage? Is it Schrodinger's? Is it worms? Or is it lash procedure? What is this? What is the name of this procedure? I think most of you should get this right. It's never been asked, but I found it a good image, which can be a probable question in your exam. Okay, so most of you got this. This is McDonald's cerclage. See the purse string-like suture? This is characteristically done in McDonald's cerclage. Schrodinger cerclage, we lift the flap of the, we dissect the anterior vaginal wall and the posterior vaginal wall, and then we put the suture in. Okay, so this typical purse string-like suture without lifting the flaps. Okay, you saw there was no dissection. Directly in the cervix, we put the four sutures. That is called as McDonald's encerclage done for cervical insufficiency. All right. So let's see how many got this right. Okay, so Rithima has gone down. Ashraman, AKKK, it's me on remaining on top. Okay, next question. Question number five, the most, read it carefully, the single most specific chromosomal anomaly seen in spontaneous abortion. Read again before you answer. The single most specific chromosomal anomaly is what in spontaneous abortion? Is it trisomy 21, 16, monosomy X, or a triploidy? Okay, so this is a little confusing. So read properly and then answer. All right. So most of you got this right. Okay. So please remember the most single, most specific chromosomal anomaly seen is monosomy X, but the most common trisomy seen in spontaneous abortion is trisomy 16. Okay. So the most common trisomy, if it's asked as a cause of spontaneous abortion, is trisomy 16, but the most common specific chromosomal anomaly is monosomy X, that is Turner syndrome. All right, so most of you got this right. I'm glad. And that does that change? Okay, so Rhythm has come on top and MJ has entered the scoreboard. Very good. Okay, so these are the top five right now. The rest of you can still catch up. Sapporo's criteria is used to diagnose what condition? Is it abruptio? Is it antiphospholipid antibody syndrome? Is it diabetes in pregnancy? Or is it twin-to-twin transfusion syndrome? Sapporo's criteria. This is an eponym. Eponyms are commonly asked in your NEET PG exam, so you should know these. Five seconds remaining. Most have answered, I guess. Okay, and the answer is antiphospholipid antibody syndrome. Okay, so for abruptio placenta, what is the name of the classification? It is Page's classification. APLA, it is Sapporo criteria. Diabetes in pregnancy is classified according to White's classification. And twin-to-twin transfusion syndrome is classified as per Quintero staging. Okay, so you should know these names. I'll repeat. Abruptio is Page's classification. APLA is Sapporo. Diabetes in pregnancy is White classification. And twin-to-twin transfusion syndrome is Quintero staging. Okay, you may not need to know the exact staging, but Sapporo's is important, Page's is important, White's classification is now no longer used, it's an outdated classification, and Quintero staging, please remember, occasionally it has been asked. Okay, so you should know twin-to-twin transfusion syndrome also. Okay, so Asherman is on, has got three answers in a row, I think five, I can't see that, so my screen is sort of blocked. Okay, so AK, Rhythma, it's me and MJ. Very good. Okay, so let's see the next question. Question number seven. Which of the following is not included in gestational trophoblastic neoplasm? Okay, this is a repeat question from previous years. Choriocarcinoma, PSTT, partial mole, or invasive mole, I think. Okay, so let me just, yeah. Okay, now I can see the entire screen. Okay, so which of the following is not included? It is partial mole. So it see the word neoplasm. All the rest are neoplasias. Choriocarcinoma, PSTT, invasive mole come under neoplasm. Partial mole and complete mole are part of gestational trophoblastic disease, GTD. When we talk about GTN, partial mole and complete mole are excluded from that classification. All right, so GTNs are choriocarcinoma, PSTT, and invasive mole, and GTDs also include partial mole and complete mole. Okay, so does that change the score? So Rhythma's back on top, very good. With then Asherman, AK, it's me, and MJ. Next question. Question number 8. Arrange the ectopic sites in decreasing order of occurrence. Interstitial, isthmus, ampulla, infundibulum. I've given you 60 seconds for this question, so look at it carefully and answer accordingly. In decreasing order of occurrence. Okay, so most common, then least common. In that order. Take your time and answer. So for the longer questions, I've given more time. Most of you have answered though already, but the timer will stop when we get all the answers. Those of you who are still joining in now, the pin is still there, 899-1199. You can still play. It's a very useful quiz for those who are joining in now. All right. They're all either previous year or I've tweaked them a bit based on previous year questions. Okay, so it's a very important topic also. Okay, so 3241, right. Okay, so the correct answer is ampulla, most common, followed by isthmus, followed by infundibulum, and least common is the interstitial. Most of you got this right. Does that change the scoreboard? Okay, so a slight change, but Rhythma, Asherman, and AK remain on top. Okay, next question. Question number 9. Which of the following is not a risk factor for ectopic pregnancy? Again, this is a repeat question, previous year question. Is it condom? Is it POPs, IUDs, or tubal ligation? Which is following is not a risk factor. Most have answered. Two are left, I think. Quickly answer. Okay, so all of you got this right. Very good. I'm glad. So, easy question. Time would matter in this. So let's see. Okay, so Asherman, slight delay in answering probably. So the positions have changed. Rhythma remains on top. Next question, question number 10. Which part of the fallopian tube is the most common site of ectopic pregnancy? But this is a slight change in the question. You have to now tell me if you know what the correct sites are in the fallopian tube. It's an image-based question. Is it A, B, C, or D? Most common site of ectopic pregnancy. We just answered this. Now you just have to show me which is the most common site. Okay, all of you answered and most of you answered correctly. This is the C. C is the ampulla. All right. So if you want to see the image, this is the image. This is the ampulla. This is the most common site of pregnancy. Okay. So let's see. Does that change the scoreboard? Okay. No. Same. Rhythma, AK, Asherman on top. Next question, number 11. A 26-year-old woman with a history of RPL was diagnosed as APLA. She is now 6 weeks. The best management is? Again, a repeat question. You see the options. I won't tell them. See the options and answer. Best management for APLA in pregnancy. What will you do? The best management. Always read the question. Questions are usually asked as best management or best investigation. Okay, so okay, very few got this right. So please remember, you always start aspirin immediately. Okay, and then once cardiac activity appears, then we always start low molecular weight heparin, never before cardiac activity. So always wait for cardiac activity to appear. Okay, and then we start low molecular weight heparin. Okay, why? Because many chromosomal anomalies, if the abortion is anyway destined to happen because of a chromosomal anomaly, it'll end up in a missed abortion. Cardiac activity won't appear. Only once we're sure cardiac activity appears, then we start low molecular weight heparin, which we continue till term. Okay, so both aspirin and heparin are given, but heparin is started after cardiac activity appears. Okay, so let's see. This would have changed the scoreboard considerably. So Asherman, I think, got this right, and that moves him up by one score. Okay, so Ridhima, Asherman, AK remain on top. Next question. Which of the following represents the correct karyotype of partial mole? Again, easy question. Correct karyotype of partial mole is? Quickly answer. The correct karyotype of partial mole. Easy question. Quickly answer. Okay, so most of you got this right. So partial mole is always triploid. Remember, partial is always triploid. Okay, and complete is always diploid. Okay, so partial mole always triploid. It could be 69XXX or it could be 69XXY, but it is always triploid. All right. So does that change? Okay, so Ridhima, Asherman, AK, MJ, it's me. Continue to be on the top five. Someone needs to break into this scoreboard and change things a bit. One second, sorry. Okay, let's go to the next question. Almost halfway. All are ultrasound signs of an unruptured ectopic pregnancy except blob sign, double bleb sign, tubal ring sign, bagel sign. All are signs of an unruptured ectopic pregnancy. Those who have gone through the previous INICT would know the answer. Okay, so I've tweaked this question a bit. Answer is double bleb. So double bleb sign, those of you who have gone through the previous INICT paper would know that this question was asked. What is a double bleb sign was asked? And that is an intrauterine pregnancy, the gestational sac and the yolks, amniotic cavity and the yolk sac form the double bleb sign. Blob sign, bagel sign, tubal ring sign, ring of fire sign, these are all seen in unruptured ectopic pregnancy. Most of you got this right, but please remember blob and bagel are also seen in an unruptured tubal ectopic. So let's see how many got this right. Okay, so Asherman moves on top, followed by Ridhima, AKMJ. It's me. Someone still needs to break into this and change the game a bit. Okay, question number 14. 36-year-old with 3 months pregnancy with bleeding. Ultrasound shows the following. What is the best management? This question comes every time in the exam. Is it suction evacuation, methotrexate, MIFI plus meso, or hysterectomy? This is the ultrasound picture. What will you do? I want everyone to get this right because this question has been asked umpteen number of times now in one way or the other. Okay, so this is, what was this? This was snowstorm appearance. This was a molar pregnancy. Treatment of molar pregnancy is always suction evacuation. It is nothing else. Okay, please remember, molar pregnancy, unless the woman is old or she requires one, in fact, we never do a hysterectomy. At least I've never seen, although the books may say, but we always do a suction evacuation. Then depending on the trend, if beta HCG is persisting or plateauing or increasing, or you find histopathological evidence of choriocarcinoma, then we give methotrexate. Okay, so the primary treatment of a molar pregnancy is a suction evacuation. Okay, so okay, so Asherman's gone down, Ridhima on top, Kunal has entered. That's very good. So someone has shook up the scoreboard a bit. Next question. Read the question and mark the correct answer. So this question was not fitting into my thing. So just read an answer. I've given a minute so you can read aram se and then answer. A 24-year-old lady with pain, spotting, not sure of her LMP. On examination, she's pale, there's tachycardia, there's hypotension, there's guarding and rigidity. UPT is faintly positive. What is the next best step in management? Is it an urgent ultrasound? Will you do an emergency laparotomy? Will you order an urgent serum beta HCG? Or will you do a dilatation evacuation? So such questions come very commonly. Okay, you should know what to do, when to do. All right, so quickly answer. Most of you have answered, I guess. 11 of you, all of you have answered. Hello. what will you do? You will, yes, you will do an emergency laparotomy. So this is typical ruptured ectopic, how it will present, right? There's tachycardia, hypotension, patient is hemodynamically unstable. There is pallor, faintly positive UPT. You will not waste time doing anything else. Anything else will simply delay your or worsen the patient's condition. So the only thing that you need to do is you need to take the patient up immediately to the OT for an emergency laparotomy. Ultrasound, cultocentesis, beta HCG is something you will not do. Beta HCG will take 5-6 hours to report. You don't have that much time. You have to immediately stop the bleeding. Okay, so you have to do an emergency laparotomy. All right, or a laparoscopy if the patient is stable. In this case, no, so an emergency laparotomy. Okay, does that change the scoreboard? No, so the top five remain the top five. Okay, next question. We're halfway done. Last 15 questions. 30-year-old with abdominal pain and spotting. UPT is positive. Ultrasound reveals this. Ultrasound Doppler, what is the diagnosis and what is the name of this sign? I put two questions in one. What is your diagnosis, most likely diagnosis, and what is the name of the sign? Okay, so most of you got this right. This is an unruptured ectopic, most likely. Yes, it could be, but with, given the scenario, what we have, it is an unruptured ectopic, and this sign, the Doppler, where peripheral vascularity is seen, it is called a ring of fire sign. It is also seen in a corpus luteal cyst, yes, but here the most likely diagnosis is an unruptured ectopic, and this is the ring of fire sign. Okay, does that change? Kunal's gone up. Okay, so things are changing. Let's see if the rest can catch up. What is the discriminatory zone for beta HCG? Okay, read and answer. What is discriminatory zone for beta HCG? Quickly, quickly, 5 seconds left. Quickly. I should have given more time, I guess. Okay, most of you didn't get to answer only. So it is a level above which an intrauterine sac should be visualized. And this value is usually 1500 units on a TVS and 6000 units on a TAS. Okay, a transabdominal scan. So basically, what is this? When the beta HCG is 1500 units, serum beta HCG, when the value is 1500, we should be able to see an intrauterine gestational sac when we do a transvaginal scan. And if we're doing a transabdominal scan, this value should be at least 6000, because TA on a TAS or a transabdominal scan, everything appears a little later. Okay, because the resolution is a little poorer, everything appears a little later compared to a TVS. So the cutoff of beta HCG on TVS is 1500. By that time, we should see a gestational sac. And for a TAS, it is 6000 international units. Some books say 5000, but Williams says 1500 and 6000. So that is what we will take. Okay, so the level above which an intrauterine sac should be visualized is the discriminatory zone. And how many have got that right? Okay, so Rhythm has got that right. That's why your score is increased. The rest remain the same. Next question. Question number 18. An RMP is qualified to perform an MTP in the first trimester if he or she has assisted in the following number of MTPs. Easy question, quickly answer. And this, those of you attended my last session would know. And it's a previous year repeat also. Everybody's answered quickly. The fastest finger first, whoever answers fastest will go up on the scoreboard now. All right, so all of you got this right. I'm very happy. Okay, so Rhythma was okay. This doesn't change the scoreboard much, but the same five remain. Okay, 19th question. Following medical method of termination of pregnancy, which contraceptive can be started on the day of taking misoprostol? Okay, read again. Following medical MTP, which contraceptive can be started on the day of taking misoprostol? Is it oral pills? Is it, can we do a tubectomy? Can we put in an IUCD or can we do a vasectomy? The best answer. Yes, oral pills. Okay, so please remember they were talking about medical termination. So after misoprostol, immediately the cavity won't be empty, right? So we can't put an IUCD, we can't do a tubectomy till we confirm that MTP has taken place. But we can start oral contraceptive pills on the day of giving misoprostol. Okay, vasectomy also is acceptable here, but the best answer would be oral pills. Okay, vasectomy can be done anytime, it doesn't really matter, does it? Okay, but oral pills specifically can be started on the day of taking misoprostol. Okay, so this changes the scoreboard a bit. ST has entered the game. Rithima, Asherman, Kunal remain on top. Okay, next question. The most common site of a uterine perforation following a vacuum aspiration is it? Is it the posterior uterine wall, the lateral uterine wall, the fundus, or the anterior uterine wall? Most common site of uterine perforation following a vacuum aspiration. You quickly answer. Okay, so no one got this right. Anterior uterine wall is the most common site, followed by the cervix. Okay, so that is the most common site. Anterior uterine wall is the most common site because when you enter with the suction cannula or with the curette, what happens is that most of the time uterus is antiverted. So you will go into the anterior uterine wall, not the fundus, not the posterior wall. And the second most common site is the cervix. Okay, perforation of the cervix. So the most co so okay, so no one got this right. So the scoreboard doesn't change. All right, next question. A 26-year-old, 6 weeks, Gravida 2 comes for MTP by medical method, as per the government of India. What is the correct protocol of doing? I've given 1 minute, so read and answer. 6 weeks MTP as per the Government of India guidelines. Okay, so think and answer. Six weeks medical MTP. Okay, 5 seconds left. I think we've got most of the answers in. All right, so the correct answer is B. All right, so it is always mifepristone first, 200 milligram, followed by 48 hours later if it is less than 7 weeks. And please remember, this is a change, new change in the Government of India protocol. If it is less than 7 weeks, then we give 400 microgram of misoprostol. If it's between 7 to 9 weeks, then we give 800 microgram. In before, it used to be standard 800 microgram. Now it's less than 7 weeks, 400 microgram is sufficient. 7 to 9 weeks, we give 800 microgram of misoprostol. This is a recent change, I think 2 years back in the Government of India protocol. So 200 milligram mifepristone followed by 48 hours later by 400 microgram misoprostol sublingual, buccal, or vaginal. Okay, so this changes the scoreboard. No, not much. No change at all. Rithima, Asherman, Kunal, MJ, ST in the top five. Next question. 25-year-old G2 at 7 weeks wants an MTP for failure of contraception. All are advantages of medical over surgical methods except. Which is not an advantage of medical MTP? Quickly answer. 10 seconds remaining. Okay, so it has a lower success rate. There is lesser instance of hemorrhage. It is non-invasive. There is less instance of PID, but there is only a 95 to 97% success rate. The success rate is more complete. The chances of completion of procedure are higher with the suction evacuation, not with a medical method. All right, so that change does not change the scoreboard. The same five people on top. Okay, last A7 questions. As per the 2021 amendment of the MTP Act, the upper limit of gestational age for significant fetal anomalies is 20 weeks, 24 weeks, 28 weeks, no upper limit. Those who were in my class day before yesterday should answer this. Okay, if you've not, then go on the link that I've shared and read. I mean, and listen. Because this is a very, very, very likely question that will come in your upcoming NEET PG. What is the upper limit for gestational age for significant fetal anomalies? Okay, and the answer is, okay, so these three have not attended my class. Okay, these six have. There is no upper limit, and I'm very glad that they've answered correctly for significant fetal anomalies. Yes, the gestational age has been increased to 24 weeks for select conditions, select indications, but for fetal anomalies, there is no upper limit. Even at 26 weeks, 28 weeks, 29 weeks, if the woman comes with a significant fetal anomaly, we have to refer her to the medical board and the medical board will decide, but there is no upper limit. Okay, so this should change the scoreboard a bit. Ashraman has come on top, so that means I think he attended my class. Rithima didn't. And Kunal, MJ, ST remain on top. Okay, next question, 24th question. 26-year-old gives history of 2 first trimester abortions, also a history of preterm delivery at 30 weeks due to eclampsia. Which investigation is advised? 2 first trimester abortions, 1 preterm delivery due to eclampsia. Which investigation will you ask her to get done? Best choice. What is the best choice? Yes, it is. So we are suspecting APLA. Okay, most of you got this right. Does that change the scoreboard? Okay, slight change, probably time difference. Okay, so Rithima and Ashraman are neck to neck. Kunal is not far behind. Next question. Read the question and answer. Sorry for the spelling mistake. This is from previous one of the INICT or NEET PG of this year only. I think NEET PG. Same question. A direct repeat question. So as I said, ectopic pregnancy keeps getting asked in some form or the other. A clinical scenario is always asked, either molar or ectopic or both. So you should be very, very, very familiar with these. Okay, so I'm surprised. This was NEET PG 2021 exact direct question. Okay, these, the conditions given in this question. Okay, 22-year-old with the woman with 6 weeks amenorrhea. She has mild pain and spotting. So we know it is an ectopic, okay, because there is a 3 to 2.5 centimeter adnexal lesion and ultrasound reveals a left-sided tubal just is given. It's an ectopic pregnancy, okay. But what is the best management option? So see here, she is hemodynamically stable. The lesion is less than 3 centimeters. Beta HCG is not mentioned. Cardiac activity unlikely, it's written here, no cardiac activity. So in such a case, the best management would be a conservative, that is a more conservative, not a surgical procedure, but a medical management, that is injection methotrexate. All right, so go through the indications of, and I'm planning to take a class on management of ectopic pregnancy because it's very commonly asked and very often you guys get confused what needs to be done. So we'll take a class on this, and this is the answer here will be injection methotrexate. Okay, most of you got this right, and it slightly changes. Kunal on top, Rithima, Kunal, Ashraman, MJ, ST remain the top five. Last five questions. 24-year-old with 2 months amenorrhea also complains of reduced appetite. There is history of tubal ectopic 1 year back. The next best investigation, read carefully. 2 months amenorrhea, reduced appetite. History of tubal ectopic. Will you do a serum beta HCG? Will you do a TS? Will you do TVS and UPT? Next best investigation. Okay, I think most of you will find this a little tricky. Okay, it's actually very simple. Yes, you will first do a urine pregnancy test. I was expecting most of you to answer otherwise. The first thing you will obviously do is first confirm pregnancy. Okay, there is no other symptom or sign which is a cause of concern, except that history of tubal ectopic has been just given to confuse you. Okay, the first thing you'll do is a UPT and then take things forward. All right, so most of you got this right. Does that change the scoreboard a bit? Yes, it does. Kunal on top, Rithima, MJ, Ashraman, and KK has come. Okay, so Ashraman is on number 4. Okay, next question. Last 4 questions. 34-year-old with 3 first trimester abortions. Prior to this, she gives a history of DNC and complains of hypomenorrhea. She is also anxious to conceive. Next best investigation. 3 first trimester abortions, DNC, hypomenorrhea, wants to conceive. Think what the diagnosis could be and then answer. TVS, hysteroscopy, TSH, or will you do a lupus anticoagulant? So what are you thinking? Depends on what your answer will be. No. Okay, most of you got this wrong. You will do a hysteroscopy. Why? Because see, 3 first trimester abortions, DNC, hypomenorrhea. Again, a very commonly asked question in the exam is Asherman syndrome. Please remember, this is Asherman syndrome. Okay. Hypomenorrhea is the clue here. So all these clinical scenarios which you get in the exam, there will be one clinching word or one clinching investigation or something which will tell you that this is what we're thinking of. Okay. At your level, we ask very easy questions, very basic questions. Okay. So hypomenorrhea, history of DNC, and how does Asherman present with secondary infertility, with recurrent abortions, with hypomenorrhea, with secondary amenorrhea. Okay. So remember these 4 symptoms of Asherman's. Okay. So what will you do if you're suspecting Asherman's? You will do a hysteroscopy and if required, an adhesiolysis. So the next best investigation amongst all of this is a hysteroscopy. Why are you thinking of APLA? Why would DNC and hypomenorrhea be given if it was APLA, right? So think of it that way. Okay, so that changes it a bit. Rhythm on top, Kunal, Asherman, MJ, and KK. Okay, last 3 questions quickly. Let's see. Double decidual sac sign is seen in early intrauterine pregnancy, intrauterine pseudo-gestational sac, tubal ectopic, or molar pregnancy. Easy question. Double decidual sac sign. This can come as an image also. Okay, most of you have answered, I guess. The correct answer is it is seen in an early intrauterine. So double decidual sac sign and intradecidual sign are seen in early, very early intrauterine pregnancy. At around 5 weeks, we see both these signs. With the gestational sac, we will see a double decidual sac sign formed by the decidua capsularis and the decidua parietalis. And we will also see the intradecidual sign. Okay, so these are signs of an intrauterine true gestational sac or an early intrauterine pregnancy. Does that change the scoreboard a bit? ST has entered again. So Rithima, Kunal, Ashraman, MJ, and ST. Second to last question. A 30-year-old lady presents at 6 weeks. On TVS, no sac is seen. Serum beta HCG is 2000. All are possible except. What is not possible? A failing intrauterine pregnancy, a molar pregnancy, an ectopic, or a recent complete abortion. So 6 weeks, nothing seen on the ultrasound, but beta HCG is 2000. So what are the possibilities? Oh, no one got this right. Okay, so a molar pregnancy is not possible. A molar pregnancy, a beta HCG will be very, very, very highly raised. At 6 weeks, it will be in lakhs. Okay, please remember that. And on TVS, you will see a molar pregnancy will be seen. A failing intrauterine pregnancy is possible. Okay, even though the beta HCG is more than the discriminatory zone, you will still be, it is still a possibility that the pregnancy is not forming. It is actually failing. Ectopic is possible. A recent complete abortion is possible. So what is not possible is a molar pregnancy. So I'm definitely taking a class on ectopic and pregnancy of undetermined location to clear your concepts. The scoreboard doesn't change because no one got it right. Okay, last question. A woman comes to the OPD for preconceptual counseling with history of 2 second trimester abortions. 2 second trimester abortions. What is the next best investigation? Is it a biopsy, hysteroscopy, karyotyping, or a TVS? This is a previous, I think, AIIMS 2019 question. 2 second trimester portions, next best investigation. So let's see after this who's at the top of the scoreboard. The answer is a TVS. Okay, so please remember, it's not first trimester. First trimester, we would do a karyotyping, okay, because the most common cause is chromosome anomalies. But second trimester abortions, chromosome anomalies can be the cause, but it goes down in the list. The more important thing we would now think of is anatomical abnormalities. So the next best investigation is a transvaginal scan. Does that change the scoreboard? So let's see the podium. Okay, so number three is Kunal. Very good, Kunal. Number two is Asherman. Okay, good, Asherman. And number one is Rithima. All right. So congratulations, all three. I hope you enjoyed the quiz. Okay. We will take a short class probably next week before the next quiz on early pregnancy diagnosis, pregnancy of undetermined location, ectopic, how to deal with all these three, because usually a question does come on these three. And the next topic of the quiz, I will tell you now only, the next topic of the quiz will be on complicated pregnancies. Okay, high risk pregnancies, complicated pregnancies. So all preeclampsia, GDM, IUGR, preterm, everything will include in one quiz. All right, because I want to finish all the topics before your NEET PG. So all high risk pregnancy, complicated pregnancy, anemia, RH negative, everything will be in the next quiz, which we will have next week. Date and time, I will let you know. But in between, we'll have a short class on pregnancy of undetermined location, ectopic pregnancy, how to diagnose, how to manage. Anyone has any doubts? You can message or unmute and ask me. But thank you all for participating. It was a good quiz. And congratulations again to all three of you.